Good evening and welcome to the April meeting of MIT Venture Lab. Tonight's meeting, or tonight's event is focused on around angel investing, and it's called Meet the Angels. I'll introduce our moderator tonight's going to be Brian Brewer. I'll introduce him in a second. I'll just introduce him here. But my name's Kirby Bartholomew. I'm the chairman of the Venture Lab program for MIT. This is a program that's really focused. It's one of two programs that the local MIT chapter runs here in Seattle. This one is focused around helping startups find the resources they need to get started and going and providing education for startup entrepreneurs. The other program, the Innovation Forum, runs alternate months with this program, and it's focused around technology and innovation. We have one more Innovation Forum this year that's coming up in May. It's called the Future of Fun. They've got some of the people who are leaders in the VR space are going to come and talk. I know Tom Furness from over at the U is going to come and speak about what he's been up to, and we've got a couple of innovators in that area, so it should be a really interesting program. This program, we will have one more program this year for the Venture Lab, which is the demo program, and that will be, it's an opportunity for startups to come and demonstrate their products. And we have a prize for them, and we go through a judging, so we've got information on our website about that, and we'll get out more information in the next couple of weeks. So I don't bore you with a lot of other information. Brian, why don't you take over and...
Thank you, Kirby. All right. I've got to put this up tall so I can... Can everybody hear me okay?
Yeah. Right.
Okay, good. So welcome. Thanks very much for coming on a nice one of our... this beautiful April evening that we have here in Seattle. We don't get this weather very much these days, so I appreciate your sacrifice. I was talking to Ryan here earlier. Ryan's got shorts on. I thought I was thinking about that too. But anyway, so this is a regular spring program that we do at the MIT Enterprise Forum Venture Lab called Meet the Angels. And we titled it that because we really want it to be a kind of informal. It's part of it is to give the opportunity for the entrepreneurial community to hear what these angel investors have to say. These are all representative of groups. And also to show that investors are very approachable. You know, that's part of it's Meet the Angels. And they'll mostly stick around for a while and do a little networking afterwards. So the plan for tonight is I'm going to have everybody introduce themselves and say a little bit about their group. And then I've got some questions I'll ask the panel, and hopefully we'll get in some good discussion. But then we're going to have plenty of time for question and answers after we're done with the discussion up here. And we'll, let's see, it's about 6:15. We'll plan to end no later than 8 p.m. All right. So a little bit of background about me. Everyone should have a program here. We've got a list of the panelists. There's information on about me. I'll just do 10 seconds of a shameless self-promotion plug. I created an online tool called the Minimum Fundable Company Test, and it's a 20-question test for entrepreneurs to see if your startup really has enough of the right stuff, if you're ready to present to investors. It's mfctest.com. There's information here. I encourage you to take it. It's free, and especially if you take the test, I would appreciate to hear any kind of feedback you have, positive, negative, or whatever, about it, about what your experience is. I would really appreciate that. So thank you very much. So let's start by talking about introducing everyone. So the way I'd like to do this is we'll start with Kai here. Kai's representative of Wings, and we'll go down the row. And what I'd like you to do is take a few minutes and introduce yourself, say a little bit about your background, and then talk about your organization and describe what it is. We'll come back around with more details about your organization. So take it away, Kai.
Thank you. That's really close. Okay, check. So my name's Kai Calder, angel investor on the board of Wings, which is a local medical technology angel group. We focus on 510K path medical devices, healthcare IT, and I guess like lab equipment, non-regulated lab equipment. My background is in both on the clinical side as a technologist in the neurosurgery space mostly, graduate degree in commercialization, and then worked for a medical device company. Been doing angel investing since 2010 on the board of one of my portfolio companies, and like I said, Wings. Wings does, it's a really small group, it's very focused. And we do about 4 deals a year. Information's in your packet.
All right. Thanks, Kai. Haresh?
Thank you for having me here. I'm Haresh Ved. I am the founder and chair of Thai Angels Group Seattle and a Thai Seattle board member. Thai is a global nonprofit that, with the key mission of promoting entrepreneurship. We have about 60 chapters in about 17 countries right now, one of the larger groups. We launched the Thai Angels Group about 3 years ago because until then it was pretty much academic. We had all kinds of programs in the organization, you know, panel discussions, event, industry trends, etc. We have a TYE program for young entrepreneur program for high school students. But until we brought in the element of capital, I thought it was still academic. So 3 years ago, the board said that maybe we should do this, and they volunteered me, and I foolishly accepted it. Now I'm enjoying 50-hour weeks with that. So, but I enjoy it. Otherwise, I would not have been here, or I wouldn't be doing it. It's a lot of fun. It makes me, brings me in front of some smart people to learn newer technologies, keep abreast of what's happening. Beyond the Thai Seattle chapter, last year I launched the Thai Angels Alliance, which is a virtual organization to promote collaboration between angel groups, Thai angel groups across the globe, because I think that is super important, not only for investors, but also for entrepreneurs and the portfolio companies, because investments can be local, but markets and the support we need is global. So that's one thing we do, and I know pretty much everyone on the panel. We think I'm a big promoter of partnerships, and I think we all have at least one, if not more, co-investments. Thank you.
I'm John Segrest. I'm with Seattle Angel. Seattle Angel is a nonprofit that we pulled together to support the production of more angel investors and better angel investing in the community. I started as a software guy, ended up doing an internet service provider, made a little money, became an economic development director, discovered that recruitment and expansion was not the way to do economic development, started the Willamette Angel Conference in Corvallis, Oregon, and then when I moved up here, saw that that niche was missing here, so created the Angel Conference. We're on round 9. The 9th one will be May 12th. And we will take our 6 finalists, put them on stage, and write a check for one of them at the end of the day after 12 weeks of due diligence of one form or another. We also have the Seattle Angel Fund, which is just finishing its first round. Its last meeting of this round will be tomorrow. And it is investing in 5 to 6 companies a year. And it's designed not so much to educate as it is to produce a good portfolio for people who are at the bottom end of angel investing. And so their process looks like the Oregon Angel Fund process. And in the process of 8 Seattle Angel Conferences and the Angel Fund, we're almost up to $4 million that we put out in investment over the last 4 years. So trying to get more people involved. So if you know somebody, which you do, because 9% of King County is qualified federally to invest, but 1% of that 9% actually invests. So if you can find that 99% and convince them to come talk to one of us and learn what angel investing is, that would be great.
We've got one here, thanks. I'm Gary Rittner, and my background is investment banking. Most of my life raising money for startups, and I do some M&A stuff. Right now I'm selling a tech company. In 1985, an attorney called me and said, hey, these angel groups are starting around the country, and why don't you start one? So I called some guys, and we did. So we have been around a while. We're Pacific Northwest focused. We're pretty open on the industry. We don't do real estate, and I should go back to the beginning. The attorney said, hey, there are no places for low-tech companies to raise money in town because all the VCs were high-tech. So we started out doing low-tech, and we can't find the low-tech now. So if somebody's got low-tech, call me.
Hi, I'm Sherry Calvert. I'm the president and co-owner of Kritsu Forum Northwest Region. We have 46 chapters worldwide and over 2,500 members. I also have teammates here, Juan Arango and Eric, who you can talk to if you are interested in Kritsu at all. But we fund, last year we did $43.5 million into 57 companies just here in the Northwest. Globally, they did about $75 million, so we are the top performing chapter of the global chapters worldwide. So we also have three funds running currently. We have a real estate fund, we have two tech funds, we're starting a space program fund, which is interesting, and a digital media and entertainment fund. So those will be running simultaneously, and the way to get into the funds is if a company receives angel investment from some of our angels or any of these groups, then they're qualified to be, you didn't know that, but anyway, any of these
it
groups.
It just sounds like a public solicitation.
No, but you get to, you guys can, they can get funding from us as well.
I'm Bill Lemon with Element 8 Angels. We were formerly known as Northwest Energy Angels, but then we realized we were investing outside of energy and investing outside of the Northwest. So, in fact, we really are still a fairly vertically minded, investment group and fund that is looking at clean tech sustainability spectrum there. We invest typically about $5 million a year in about 10 new companies and 10 follow-ons, something like that. And new this year was an investment fund, so that classically our members invest as individuals, but we're looking for more diversification in the investment portfolio, so created a fund that is managed by three of our board members who all have venture capital management experience. Personally, I'm an energy guy. I've always been an energy guy. Came up working for Pacific Gas Electric Company in their R&D labs before moving to the Northwest. These days, the last 10 years or so, I've been an investment banker in renewable energy, both startups and project finance.
Hi, my name is Doug Beavis. My tagline has always been a finance guy with a marketing personality. I was CFO for NBBJ Architects from 78 to 90. And in 84, we drank the Kool-Aid by giving our architects a $20,000 CAD station to replace their $1 pencil, trading off capital versus labor. And so that was computer-aided design, which became computer-aided design and drafting, which became computer-aided engineering. Which became paperless construction documents. So I drank the Kool-Aid then and really have saw the how it transformed that industry and was crazy enough to invest in other companies since that time. Done two IPOs as a CFO, local tech companies. Sympathetic to what you folks do because I've done road shows, 81 presentations and 18 city stops facing some really nasty people. So I've never wanted to be a CEO because I respect technologists and sales guys. If I can follow a technologist who can sell, I'll carry his or her briefcase anywhere. I've been a member of Alliance of Angels for 15 years now. I'm also a member of the Puget Sound Measure Club with Gary. I think you've got the stat sheets in there. They're pretty straightforward. We've been one of the top 10 angel groups in the country for a number of years straight. Invested about $10 million a year in about 20 companies, about 140 members now versus 120 in the program. What you don't know is that we have a board, 10 of us who are all active angel investors, serious players, and our dues payers are nominally the folks to whom we report, but we spend an enormous amount of time making sure we are entrepreneur friendly and are helping those two groups meld together because neither succeeds without the other, and our goal is to have both succeed.
Okay, thank you, Doug. Hey, before I go on, I wanted to just make sure, point out in your handout, this insert, this back and front insert with the information about the angel groups and their investing that they've done for the last few years. Shout out to the folks at the City of Seattle, Rebecca and David, who helped put this information together. So it's also available for download on my FundingQuest website if you want it in electronic form. Okay, so now... Thanks very much for the panel, for everybody, for introducing yourselves and your groups. So we're going to start out. I want to start out with a sort of a easy question about what are you looking for in an entrepreneur who's applying to your group? What are some of the key traits that you would like to see when they apply, not present, just apply. Any order here? This is everybody jump in. Fight over the microphones if you need to. So.
Market pain.
So say it again, Bill.
Market pain. Of our companies that we funded that are struggling, they don't struggle because they can't make the product work. They struggle because they can't make the market buy.
Anybody else?
Well, I would go with the CEO doesn't listen.
Okay, so that's the thing you're not looking for.
Don't want it.
In other words, you're looking for CEOs who do listen. Is that correct,
correct,
Gary?
Correct. Okay.
They have to, you know, looking at the companies, again, like Bill said, they have to have a product or service that's wanted and needed in the community, and they have to have a good business plan. Not the business plan, not so much as the sales strategy. I think that is number one, and working on the team.
Thanks. I turned it off by mistake. So our process is slightly different than most of the others because we're a fund with a deadline at the Seattle Angel Conference. And so we're expecting that we are going to see progress. So we have 12 weeks where every week we're engaging with all of the companies, and we want to see the movie of your startup, which means week by week we'd like to be getting data and communication about what's going on with your program and that you're making motion. You have a team. That team is actually engaged with customers. Your customers are paying you, and there are more customers this week than last week, and you see that there will be more next week, and it's growing, so we can see that flow. We're looking at companies that are very close to first revenue, and so there's a lot of wobble in these companies, and we are not so much afraid of wobble as we are of people who are not paying attention. And so if you see the wobble and you go straighten out that plate, that's okay. If you see the wobble and you don't move to do anything about that plate falling, then we got trouble because we know you're going to have more plates to spin in just a couple investments later.
That's a great analogy about the spinning plates.
So I wasn't sure whether you were just supposed to give one example.
No.
Okay, just clarifying. There are lots of things typically we want. We want a complete package. In an entrepreneur, it's not just one thing, it's multiple things, and I can list them and I can talk for 4 hours. But typically, a couple of key things we look at is, you know, one who puts the customer first, ahead of themselves, ahead of the product, ahead of the technology, anything else. If there is no customer validation, then if there is no customer need, if there's a need for customer education, this is the kind of entrepreneur we do not really like. Secondly, the entrepreneur has to be a people's person. You know, he should be able to flirt with everyone possible, not only girls, you know, especially investors and customers and all. There should be good storytellers. I think it's all about the story. One of the key things that's missing here is coming up with a coherent story of their whole company, starting from start to end. And last, I mean, there are lots of things, I'll keep it short. The one thing which is very important is to be able to sell. They have to sell to their investors, they have to sell to their employees, they have to sell to their customers who will be willing to pay. If they cannot do this, then maybe they are not the right persons to bet on, at least that's what we feel.
Yeah, there's some good things to look for. I would add to that, specifically for medical, entrepreneurs who have experience, one, in their specific sector. If they're working toward addressing an industry, they know that industry. And also, they know about medical technology startups, because there are a lot of pitfalls, from the FDA to regulatory to reimbursement. There's a lot of things that go wrong. And if they don't have that experience, they can draw to them advisors who do. I think that's And then that third thing is being able to draw people to them. You know, the entrepreneur can't do everything. They need to surround themselves with really smart people who can do those things.
Are we going to keep going here?
Keep going, Gary.
Okay. to add to what Haresh said about sales, we see too many deals where you got a couple tech guys, and you'll ask them the question, okay, tell me about who's got sales experience. Well, we're going to bring a sales guy on later. Well, that's not the way to do it. If you're in product development, you got to get that sales guy on board early during product development because he's the guy that's going to be selling it. And even if, I talked to somebody the other day, and they got their sales guy. He's working with them on nights and weekends and keeping his full-time job until they can afford to pay him, and that works. But nothing happens in the world, you guys heard, and ladies, nothing happens in the world until somebody sells something.
Let me second Gary's comments with a limerick I remember from business school 40 years ago. So tell me true, or else my friend be gone with you. Technology works more what the darn thing does for me. Screwed it up, but the concept is if you're in love with your technology and you're not communicating with the customer, you're just not going to pull it off. Other things I might probably add would be I'm very CEO-centric, as Gary mentioned, and team-centric. If a team has more than three founders, I'll be watching carefully as to whether it's overpopulated in that zone. If it does not have a CEO, I won't go near it. And if I see a CEO who is not kind and respectful to every, even the most junior person on their team, I'm out of there.
Excellent. So my next question was about any kind of red flags, but I think you guys have already talked about a lot of those. But anything else come to mind about particular kind of things that you notice that are real turnoff that maybe entrepreneurs just might not be aware of? Anything like that? John?
So there's a fine line between visionary and arrogant. And so the very difficult thing is to say to someone, I see the world this way, and they say, no, you're totally wrong. We're going that way. There's a certain amount of that you need, but it needs to be the spice on the top, not the core of the ice cream cone, because when you're committed to this fallacy and you don't listen to any of the data around you, all sorts of things go bad. And so that's just the beginning of this not treating people well. You not only have to treat all your staff well, but you have to treat your customers well and your investors well and know when the world is not following your wishes.
Also, one of the biggest turnoffs is valuation, obviously, and how much you're taking as a salary. You should not be taking market rate for a salary. You should be taking much less as a founder. So that's a big red flag for me.
So if you can possibly do it, your CEO and founders should be taking their money out of revenue, not out of investment. I know that's not always possible, but that's what you should plan on if you can plan it.
So investing in entrepreneurship is a world of contradictions. You know, things could be right for one, would work for one, may not likely work for the other. But in general, I think somebody who is coachable, somebody who is not working with blinkers on, which is also required to focus, but they are open to feedback, especially criticism, creative criticism. Instead of avoiding that, they should be open to that like sponges. It's not like they would go and execute exactly what the feedback is, but they should be able to analyze, put everything together, and then come up with a strategy, a plan to execute. And these are the entrepreneurs that succeed in my mind. So if somebody is not willing and open, that to me would be a big red flag.
I'd second a lot of that and add to it that not having a well thought out plan is a big red flag. If the entrepreneur doesn't at least have a roadmap, then you know, that's a problem because there's so many moving pieces. They should at least have a plan from which to deviate. I think I heard the saying, plans are useless. Planning is essential. Make sure you have a decent plan that at least makes sense.
How many people in the room have a Twitter address? Like about half of you. How many of you tweeted in the last hour? Like 8 of you. So I'm expecting that a CEO that's telling a story is building a personal brand. When they're building a personal brand, they have a social media stream of people that are following them, because that's the cheapest thing they could be doing to tell their story and build personal brand. And so when your habit is to sit in a room and do nothing, we got a problem.
Going back to the CEO, my number one rule in life is to do business with highly ethical and highly motivated people. And when we come across to see, and I'm sure everybody would say the same thing up here, if you run across a CEO who's, you're starting to think about his ethics, and then you walk, you just forget it.
All you have to sniff is something.
Or sniff it.
Yeah. I'd just like to add, you know, one other thing is the introverts, the very smart folks. It's not always the smartest guy will be the successful entrepreneur. So these are a little bit dangerous. If they don't come out and if they don't network, which is so essential, it is going to be super difficult. As an investor, if I don't know the person, it makes it that much harder, because I have my, you know, defensive walls up for some unknown reason. I'm still open. I listen to everything. But if he is referred to me, it's a lot better. I'll look at him. I'll give him the time, attention. I'll give it anyways, but I have my guard up. So that's very important for entrepreneurs, to not to, if somebody comes and says, I know it all, I can do it all, but that's not enough. You know, an entrepreneur, a company needs, more than 24 hours of product development, sales, marketing. There are so many aspects to a business. If this one person does not have a team and walks in and has no idea who the other supporting co-founders are, it's a huge, huge red flag for us.
Yeah, another one is companies or CEOs that are seeking serious funding, more than just friends and family, maybe seed, who haven't quit their day job. I want to see an entrepreneur who's burned the boat at the shore. There's no turning back. It's got to work, or the house is, going to get foreclosed on. You know, the fire under their butt really goes a long way.
Commitment, I guess, is what you mean. Demonstrated commitment. Right. So one of the, in working with clients over the years who go through this process of seeking funding from angel groups, one thing I've noticed is that there's a lot of attention paid to applying to the groups, and going through the screening process and getting your pitch ready, and you get that pitch done, and you get the excitement that you go pitch to a few groups, and there's all this excitement, and then you get some interest, and then all of a sudden the angel investor groups talk about this thing called due diligence, and so, which is a big burden on entrepreneurs to provide all the information. So I wonder if any of you folks on the panel have any tips for entrepreneurs about how to prepare and how to go through the due diligence process once there's some interest.
We take due diligence, as all the groups, very, very seriously. And we have a due diligence. There's books out there. One of the other angels, I'm trying to think of his name, just wrote a book about it. One of our local guys. I'm trying to remember. Anyway, there's many, many.
Startup Wealth by Josh.
Yeah, Josh Mayer. So Josh just wrote a book about it. All of us have our own due diligence handbooks. Look at them ahead of time when you're coming through. But I've just been asked by my investors last week to create a accountability statement where, as an entrepreneur coming in, we're going to hold them accountable for a certain number of reports back to the investors, because investors are tired of not hearing something's wrong until it's too late. So we're developing, Juan Arango's here, he's developing a sheet to legally bind, obviously they don't have to do it, but to say, if you come through this forum, if you come through one of these groups, the minimum you should do is X, Y, and Z. And this is what we expect from you. So you have to be accountable. We're interviewing you as much as you're interviewing us when you come through the process. And if you don't communicate with the investors, even when things are going wrong, that's the most important time to communicate with us, because then we can help you and we can save you. If you don't tell us till it's too late, you're blacklisted, at least from me.
So from due diligence, frequently people are coming, let's start with this. It is not wise to send an application to all of us on the same day. there's a series of things. Seattle Angel Conference, I hope, is the earliest. We look at people that are pre-revenue, that are little tiny one guy and a dog and an idea, all the way up to maybe $1 million in their request. While some, like Kretsu and Alliance of Angels, tend to be later on. They like to see regular revenue with regular growth kind of things with lots of detail. So start with the ones that are smaller and go to the ones that are larger and build your capacity so that by the time you hit the ones that you're going to ask a lot of money from, you're all polished. And so Seattle Angel Conference, we're going to invest in one out of 60 companies. But all 60 companies are going to take a giant step forward because there's angels that have reached in and touched their due diligence. So you have a due diligence data room that you're putting all your data in. You know where your cash flow projection is. You know where your sales metrics are. You know where your agreements with all your founders are. All that stuff is in one place, a digital place that you can share with people, at least on Gust in some form, in some shareable mechanism. More than half of the companies we see don't have anything put together at all. And so do due diligence on yourself first. Get that sort of warmed up. It'll shorten the process for everyone. And there are plenty of people here that would be glad to go through and walk through the things that they're looking for and help you get that stronger. He wants to ask a question. You ready for questions from the audience?
The book that you mentioned,
John? Oh, Startup Wealth by Josh Maher, M-A-H-E-R. It's sort of an overview what the angels look for. And what we're looking for at the early part is much lighter than what VCs look at for at the farther end. And so understand that it will get harder and more complex as you move along. But engage in the things that are important. You should know what the top 10 risks to your company are. And you should document them and document what the plan is to mitigate those risks. And every time you mitigate a risk and you pull it off the plate, hallelujah, your valuation just went up.
Just a correction for the record, Alliance of Angels does invest in pre-revenue companies. And when I tell folks that contact me, I said, come to Alliance of Angels early for sure, because if you aren't ready to talk to broader investment groups, we have a pitch clinic. First of all, we're a cheap date, $95 to participate. And if you're not ready, you can go through our pitch clinic to figure out how your deal might be better communicated or better structured. Brian's program is excellent for all groups, by the way. Gary, I tell folks to come to you next, but because I'm a member of his groups too. But Jane Park came through AOA about 8 years ago from Julep, and I said, Jane, I don't do real estate deals. I'm into ones and zeros, but pitch to everyone in this town because it's a small town, and create your persona, your brand, and your relationship with investors in the community, bankers and whomever, early. Go to all the groups because you'll see these same people next time, and so go pitch to all of them. Last comment, everybody complains about how long it takes and how hard it is to raise money. The fact is, for the CEO, you are always raising money, you're always communicating with investors, and get used to it. I got a letter just the other day from a company, my only out-of-state company invested in California. This was a letter to all A, B, C, D, and E rounds. Okay, I was in the A round, and haven't invested since. And because I know a guy on the board for 40 years, so I'm not worried about my investment. It'll happen. But the point is, you'll always be raising money. Don't complain about it. See it as an opportunity to communicate with people that can help you make your future.
Two really important points on this. I think, you know, due diligence is huge. I've seen a lot of companies that look promising come through, and they just don't get through due diligence. I think there's a whole lot of reasons, but two things that you can really do to help your success. One, find a deal lead. Find someone in an angel group that will be your champion. So for those of you who don't know, the way I think all of these angel groups work is the members make their own decisions. Now there are a lot of funds, and the fund will make a decision, but for the most part, the angel groups, the members, will make their own decision individually. But when they work together, that's when the magic happens, because they all get to talking amongst each other. I would say that within any one group, there's probably not enough expertise in any one group to really know your deal. If you can get people working together through several groups and bring them all together with a deal lead, your chances of success are just a lot higher.
I beg to differ in that we find experts in every, there's 465 local members, and I think with these groups as well, because we've used Alliance of Angels in all the groups. Gary comes to my meetings, Haresh comes to my meetings. We share deal flow, so we can find the expertise, don't worry. But we have a dedicated due diligence director that his only job is to match the CEOs, the presenters, with the investors, and to get that deal done. And we looked at how many deals last year? We looked at 82 and we funded 70.
We funded 57.
57, I'm sorry. So we have a really great funding rate, but that's a lot of work done on the due diligence side. And I think every single group has a due diligence process. So, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I cannot emphasize enough the importance of due diligence. You know, every hour or you spend on researching the company as an investor, you probably are more likely to find something that may not fit. And that can help you reduce the risk. It's not that you do more due diligence, it will be a sure bet, but it at least reduces the risk. Now, for entrepreneurs, it is super important in my mind. The more it gets them, it helps them become more organized as they put the packages together. Sometimes they say, that, hey, this investor, this group is taking a long time. But it's because the due diligence package is incomplete. It's not comprehensive. It's not a clear story, a coherent story. It doesn't give the right message. There are discrepancies. So that's why there's a lot of back and forth. So it is very important for entrepreneurs to consistently do this. Not only it will help them through their thinking process, help them identify issues that they might have, that they might have missed otherwise, but putting together a package will really, really help them. And from investors' point of view, we don't have all the expertise. So we go to other groups that have the expertise. And we do get their due diligence packages, then we do our own. But again, in our group, it's a little different. You know, we probably sometimes start with Kiritsu's package, which is like 300 pages. And we just summarize it to 3 pages or 7 pages. And that's what our members really like. And use it. But we definitely start with experts who know the field more. And TAGS is a totally technology, not totally, but mostly a group of technology folks from Microsoft, Amazon, Google, etc. We've actually extended into health sciences. We have a medical devices company that we did with Wings and all. A couple of other pathology and a couple of companies, but again, we started our due diligence based off of someone else's and then completed and then made a decision to invest.
So one of the habits that entrepreneurs that are in a hurry have is to find a checklist and then go down the checklist and fill out all the boxes in the checklist. And in the result of that, have no real idea of what the risks to their company are. So this is not a due diligence by filling out the checklist. This is an analysis of your company for risk, identifying those risks and explaining where the risks have been mitigated and where they're not. So don't pick a checklist, especially don't pick a due diligence checklist from a venture capitalist and then try to use it for an early pre-seed deal. It'll just be a lot of work and produce the wrong data for people. So think about where the core risks are and answer that. Number one thing that I think you heard earlier is team. And the second number one thing is market engagement, you know, customer engagement with what you're doing. So if you mitigate those two risks satisfactorily, that's a good start.
And I'd just like to add one other thing from the investor's point of view. Typically, we kind of meet someone, we like someone. It's a gut feeling we have, which is important, which is essential. But I think that along with a checklist to what to look for in a company, the due diligence list, if we combine the two, it makes it that much better and safer. So I would definitely, that's what we tend to do in TAGS.
Haresh has said the magic words, gut feel, because when push comes to shove, it's gut feel, and do I have it? No. And do I wish I had it? You bet. Because gut feel about the CEO and the team, and most of you guys, hopefully most of you guys realize that women are more intuitive than men. And so we need more female investors, because we can follow them, because they're going to be smarter than us.
All right, well, Gary, that's a great segue to one of my questions here. By the way, I should mention that John Sechrest is representing both the Seattle Angel Conference and the Seattle Angel Fund. He's involved with both those. But the leader of the Seattle Angel Fund is Susan Preston, and she apologizes she couldn't be here tonight. She loves this kind of event, but she can't be here. But if Sue were here, then there would be 2 of 8 women on this panel. And there's a lot of information in the press, in society these days about how can women take advantage of more of opportunities. And so how does that, what kind of thoughts do you have? We'll start with you, Sherry. All right. The question is, what do you see that can be done, or what are you doing, or what are your groups doing to encourage women to get involved in entrepreneurship, either as entrepreneurs or investors?
I'm actually speaking at 4 different events this week about that topic. I'm speaking at the casino in Bainbridge Saturday to the Association of Women University Women, if any of you women are going. But we have, women, it's super important. 70% of America's inheritance over the next few years is going to go to women. Women are increasing their wealth ahead of men for the first time in history. So women are actually making more money now than they did in the past, more than the men at the rate of it. So we've got quite a few, there's a lot of women out there with a lot of money, really smart, smart women. Marty's laughing because we were talking about this earlier. But it's super important to get the women engaged. It's true. Women have a whole different perspective on what's happening with the group. We look at things differently. I have to laugh that somebody came through with, I'm just going to say it, the vibrator. And all the men in the room were mortified. And all the women were like, oh, interesting. But there's just some things that we need the girls for. I mean, there's a lot of products and things, baby products, designer things that the men just feel very uncomfortable with. Same thing happens to the women. There's some guy came in with all this fitness equipment, and I'm like, it's taller than me, so it just, we need both. And I think the women entrepreneurs, we love to support them. I will honestly give a female CEO, this is unfair, but it's true, I will give, if they're equal, if you two walk up to me equal, I will give her the shot first, because I want to see more women CEOs and more women entrepreneurs.
So we have a program that comes town, it's out of New York, but it's called the Pipeline Fellowship, which is doing something that's awfully close to the Seattle Angel Conference in terms of its structure of training women to be investors. And so there have been several graduates of that are now sort of gathering informally. I don't think they're quite an angel group yet, but we have hope that they will be. There is a group called Tonic, which is an impact investing, which seems to have attracted a higher percentage of angels who are female, but they're looking at all asset classes, not just angel investing. So there's a couple of places where we're seeing more progress. Things have been somewhere between 7% and 15% for each of our rounds for the angel conference. Each angel conference round, we have half of them are new. So we try to have half brand new investors. And so I'm definitely actively recruiting. So if you know somebody who's qualified, I'd love a conversation.
I usually don't get into these discussions because my first wife was a feminist, and my second wife basically is my boss. but I will say that Alliance of Angels, our board, we have 2 women on the board, and about 30% of our members are women, so there's a lot of opportunities there. I think that many of them would say if you were 18 years old, major in STEM instead of feminist studies, and you'll be amazing how successful you'll be in the entrepreneurial world. I want to change the subject just a bit while I've got the mic here, is I hope there's some non-CEOs in the room, because the role of a CEO is an unusual one, quite stressful, and not everyone needs to be the CEO. If you're a junior, my advice is work for people who are leaders and are winners. If you work for the people with those two characteristics, do a brain suck, work your tail off, and learn, that's more important than saying, I want to be an entrepreneur this week, I'm going to do a business plan on the weekend, and I want to be a CEO. Last comment is, go see the movie Steve Jobs. It's a nightmare for me because I work for people that wild. But following around and learning from people like that is an experience in itself, and that's a signal and a message and a scenario of what a lot of technology is like.
So in our case, about 25% of our board is female. and comparable 30%, I think, of our active members. And we've reached over the last 6 months have actually put together a formal program, what we call the Women of Element 8, which is, I guess you'd call it a SIG, within the group. And it's a regular quarterly women's only meetings just to talk about the issues around investing and investing within Element 8 and sustainability, just as we continue to try to remove any barriers, intentional or unintentional, to from full engagement.
Yeah, I think having a woman entrepreneur or woman on the board or somehow involved with the company is super important because, as Sherry said, I mean, the perspective they can bring is could be very distinct, very different than what men typically think. So it's very important. And I'm all for women. I love women. We have women investments or investments in companies run by women. However, one thing I would like to say is, at least for me and for our team, it's not about man or a woman or a gay or a lesbian or anything. It's just about the right person, the right time, the right product, the right fit, the right domain expertise. It's the right person to build that company, whether the right person to advise someone. It's all about the person. You want the right person, otherwise it can be fatal for the whole company. So we focus more on the right fit rather than it's a man or a woman or something else.
So, you know, this is clearly a very delicate subject, hot button issue for a lot of people. I think I would say that I'm hopeful looking forward. I'm still relatively young, and if I invest well, I have a long angel investing career ahead of me, we'll see. But I think as more women get into angel investing, it's going to improve angel investing. In general, not everybody's like this, but in general, I think women are more collaborative. They listen better, work better with a bunch of people, maybe because they've had to their whole life to, you know, get by in a man's world. But I think those skills in particular are well-suited to angel investing because that's what we're doing. Every angel investors work for themselves. They don't have to show up at the office. They don't need a paycheck. They're not going to get fired by their boss. So it needs to be collaborative, and people need to work together. And for a startup company to get funded, generally, it's going to take more than one angel. So I'm hopeful for, you know, where angel investing is going.
Anybody else want to chime in? Or that's enough? All right, well, thanks. We'll have plenty of time for Q&A later, so you can grill them as well. And now, while I have the mic, I want to jump in with a thought that occurred to me while the panelists were talking. You know, if you look at this sheet here, you'll notice that the total amount invested in 2015 is roughly $70, $80 million in that range, plus or minus. But you know, one thing I emphasize to people, entrepreneurs that I work with, is that the money that's invested through the local angel groups here is only a small fraction of the money that's invested in this region in startup companies. It's really only a small fraction. And so I want to follow up on something you said earlier, Doug. You talked about networking and getting connected with people. That is if you're looking to get on this path to raising funding from investors, by far the best thing you can do and start today is to build your network of all, you know, of colleagues, of service providers, of attorneys, CPAs, other entrepreneurs, and especially investors, and all those people will lead you to other investors. And so don't, like somebody said about sitting in, you know, you don't want to sit in your chair in your office all day and not do anything. He said, I highly recommend one of the best things you can do is get out and network and build that network. Anyway, that's just my two cents. Yes, Doug. Yeah.
Let me kind of compliment that with a couple of thoughts. First of all, even if you're an introvert, you have to act like an extrovert. Okay. Johnny Carson did it for 30 years. There's a introverted guy, and he stepped across the tape every night, five nights a week. So you have to act like an entrepreneur, force yourself to do that, and be an extrovert. I came back to town in 96 after being fired in Denver. It's happened to me two or three times. It's something you need to go through, those younger folks in the audience. Anybody I met with, I would ask them, first of all, I would take only 20 minutes of their time and respect that, and I would ask them, who else should I be speaking with? Ask them who they would suggest that you meet with. If you create a good impression, and they've concluded you will not embarrass them by a referral to whomever, they'll give you names. The first three names that come to mind are the three you should go for. I had one guy sat down, he went through his whole Rolodex, gave me 40 names. I couldn't work through 5 or 10. It's unbelievable. This is a really friendly town. This is not New York, Chicago, Boston, Philly, and I've been to all those places. This is a really friendly place. It's amazing how people will help you, but you need to be an extrovert. You need to ask and ask who they suggest that you talk to, write down the names, and follow up with those folks.
Yeah, just to continue on that thought, you know, Seattle is an interesting place, and I completely agree, unlike many other places. But one of the key differences between entrepreneurs here versus the Valley or some other places, you know, they are very open. They'll just grab someone in the Starbucks or conferences and just share their ideas. The more you discuss, the more you share, the more you learn. You know, out of 20 feedback you get, let's say, 19 will be the same, but one could be that key aha feedback that you can incorporate that can help you so much. Seattle people are a little afraid that, hey, if I share my idea, somebody will steal it and run and build a company. It's not easy. If it is, well, all, you know, hats off. But it's not that easy. It's not just the idea. It's a lot that to build a company. The second thing is you, as an entrepreneur, cannot do it alone. As I said earlier, you need a team of key people with complementing skill sets. The sooner you get them on board, the better it is. And the more important thing is to get the right people on board. So they will be your champions, and they have connections. So it's like, you know, this effect that they'll bring in other investors, other professionals, etc., to help you than you can ever do it on your own.
Yeah, just a quick point. Keep in mind, you might all know this already, but Seattle is a tiny town. It may seem like a big city, but everybody knows everybody. Within two calls, any of us could find somebody who has worked with you. So mind your reputation.
When interviewing an attorney, which you obviously have to do, one thing you might consider is during the interview, and I realize if you don't have any money, then, you know, it's kind of a one-sided deal. But if you're in a position to ask him how much he helps his startups, does he refer investors? Does he introduce them to the groups and tell some group leader, hey, this is kind of an exceptional deal? So that's one thought about raising money.
Okay, thank you. So another question that a lot of people ask me about, and I'm sure some of you have some standard answers for this, but what are your thoughts about your preferences in terms of a convertible debt deal versus a priced round? This is always gets some lively discussion going. I'd like to hear from everybody on this.
So the Seattle Angel Conference is by default a convertible note, because we expect to be early, because we have many investors that don't know what they're doing because they're brand new for the first time and want to simplify as much as possible. And so we start with the convertible note with a cap, and about half the time we end up taking a price preferred round as the company has some kind of deal terms they want to talk about.
And what about Seattle Angel Fund?
Seattle Angel Fund is much more likely to prefer a preferred round note and not do convertible notes, but they will do convertible notes.
Okay.
Does everyone here know what a convertible note cap is?
Why don't you tell us, Gary?
Oh, God. Why don't you, John, you tell them.
So in a preferred round, you're taking equity, shares of stock, but you have special rights, typically things like voting rights, information rights, or liquidation preferences. And so investors want to have some of those rights and generally don't want to be in your common stock round. A convertible note is a loan structured as debt where at the end of that time period, it's also sometimes called a bridge loan, where at the end of that time period, you fully intend for it not to ever be paid back, but to convert into stock at some kind of discount. So our typical discount is 25%. We expect that within 12 to 18 months, you've done the next round, that next round has much more data about you because, of course, because we gave you money, you made progress, and now you have a higher valuation. So because you have a higher valuation, you give us a discount so that we can get paid for that help that we provided. So a loan, the interest rate you really don't care about, the term you care about somewhere between 12 and 18 months, and then it converts to stock because you raised another round. If you're not raising another round, a convertible note doesn't work.
And I'm just going to add on, now I can add on because he set the table here. Historically, notes, before they had caps, so you do a convertible and you're going to convert at a 20% discount. So you come in a first round, the seed round, and maybe for whatever reason, it's called a $2 million pre. Well, the company's really hot, and they do the next round at $10 million, which is really great, except in your case, you took all that front-end risk and you're going to convert at 20% off of $10 million. And that's where the cap came in. So if you had a $4 million cap on that example, 20% off of $10 million is, what, $8 million? Yeah. But the cap is 4, so the note would convert at 4. And in our group, I can see the guys. Well, I can see guys drifting away from convertible notes. So when I'm talking to an investor and they haven't decided, I tell them to do a preferred.
Right. Just to continue on that thought again, I think convertible notes unnecessarily get a bad reputation. If done it right, it's good. It's beneficial for everyone, and especially the entrepreneurs also, because it's a low-cost, quick thing instead of going through the whole shebang of setting up equity rounds. Secondly, if the right terms are included, then it's beneficial for both. It shouldn't end up being that earlier investors take all the risk and then entrepreneurs make a bunch out of it. So that's why, as Gary said, cap is quite important. It's hard to value a company early on. Nobody knows what's going to happen. But we at TAGS prefer preferred rounds, and we've had companies come to us and we had them change their strategy into price rounds. That's what our members like to see.
I'd like to ask the panel, what do you demand on a convertible note if you never do an A round, or a B round, so in a sense there's no conversion. How do your notes read on that? What are you asking for?
Well, it's whatever at that point we're swinging the big club of bankruptcy, and so it's like, or we could talk about some warrants here.
Well, a better question. I didn't word that right. A better question is on an acquisition. How does your note read?
So something I've...
I don't have some great answer for that.
Yeah, so to Haresh's point about the terms and convertible notes getting a bad rep, I've seen notes that have, if there's an acquisition, there is a conversion immediately preceding an acquisition. So that'll be in there. So the note will convert before an acquisition. And if they never raise another round, I've seen notes that will convert on a certain day, like essentially convert on maturity at a certain rate. So it kind of takes care of those two points.
So Kai, in terms of wings, does the group do convertible notes ever?
Yeah, I think it's, so what I've been to a lot of panels and talked to a lot of angels, and what I hear is, there are people who dislike convertible notes and prefer priced rounds, but I don't hear of too many people who prefer convertible notes. Like, the people who accept, you prefer convertible notes?
We're just too early.
Oh, yeah, for early stage stuff, that makes sense. Oh, yeah, so for Wings, we do a lot of convertible notes. I think really the bigger question for us is, what makes sense for the company? I think we'd prefer a priced round, but if the company's really early and only raising $500,000, it doesn't make sense to do a priced round. As long as the terms are good, I think that's okay, the key.
So, Doug, how about A of A?
On the my personal view is on the comparison of the two, when the company gets in trouble, the shape of the casket is not material when the company is out of cash. Okay, toes up, call it what you want, bury it. Okay. So I don't worry too much about the text.
John,
about,
you can tweet that quote. The shape about, of the casket is particular. Okay.
Actually, cremation is also an alternative. That's what I mean. About 7 years ago, AOA put together a down the middle of the fairway generic preferred round document. And we got all the law firms down to buy off on it. K&L Gates, who's a sponsor for AOA, does a $5,000 A round for you. So go to our website for the generic suggested middle of the fairway A round preferred document. 2 years ago, we put together a convertible note on the same basis. Go to our website, and you'll see, actually, it's probably been 6 months ago, it finally worked through our board members, who are smart guys, put it together. So generic language there, but a casket's a casket if things could not go well.
So two thoughts. The first thought is there's another kind of document that's starting to show up in town called SAFE, which is coming out of the Bay Area, and it looks a lot like a convertible note, but it's called something else. And in general, I don't like it at all. But one of the things it does is it gets rid of this terms thing. You just sort of go forever, which it makes total sense if you're Y Combinator and you have 50,000 people coming on your front end and you cherry pick the ones you want, and the ones that are going to die on the other end, you're going to ignore anyway. But from a Seattle point of view, the reason we have the term in it and the right to call on the loan is to get the entrepreneur back to the table. So we want to have that conversation about what to do next. Do we take a stake and put it in the heart of the company and kill it and force bankruptcy? Which we've had that discussion on some of ours, and it's a serious contemplation because we think that it's not only better for the investors, it's better for the entrepreneur not to keep nursing this dead whale across the beach that they're trying to kick. But the opportunity to renegotiate, get some warrants, figure out a new deal, try to restructure, have that hard conversation about firing the spouse who's making a mess or whatever the thing is, being at the table is important. And a lot of times entrepreneurs don't want to come to the table. They don't give us the reports, and when everything's a mess, they really don't want to do it. And so by having that hook, we have a legal way to bring them to the table. So if you see SAFE, I suspect that the SAF SAFE things are not what most people up here want, and that they would prefer to see something much more simple and effective so that we keep negotiations going well.
Okay. Sherry or Bill, do you have any comments about your groups and convertible notes? Hmm?
I just like to add something. I think people.
Yeah, well, Bill, go ahead.
I thought you were done before.
Let's hear from Bill next.
Sorry. Are you sure?
Absolutely. Maybe you'll just say what I want to say.
It's never hard to get these guys to talk.
I would rather do a convertible note in a great deal than a priced round in just a good one.
Right.
So we're pretty flexible, including even for companies that are actually generating revenue. We'll do revenue-based financing, where we'll take, you know, so many cents off of every dollar that comes in the front door, and maybe some warrants on the back end as an upside. Because in some cases, some of these, you know, cleaner tech deals are slow to go up the big hockey stick, but they have steady business.
Okay, nice. Haresh, you have the floor now.
Thank you. I just wanted to add that, I think it's not that critical to spend too much time at an early stage, whether we should go this route or that route. A few good terms are good enough, because you invest in a company not for, you know, $5 million or $10 million. You're in for the long haul, right? You want it to grow to $500 million, $1 billion, possibly go IPO, which may not happen. And then it's moot, you know, like Doug said. If it succeeds, it's not a problem. If it fails, it's not a problem. So when is the problem? The problem is if, let's say, the company is so, you know, lifestyle, grows to a lifestyle company that doesn't die, it doesn't go anywhere. But you as an investor, what do? You know, you don't have any way out. So for the first time, we actually did a recent deal, and we got some terms in. And again, this also depends on the desperation of the entrepreneur, how desperate he is, how willing he is to add these terms. But we had these terms added that in case nothing happens in a certain period of time, investors have the option of pulling the money out with a certain dividend or returns or something. So that kind of safeguards that third case, which may happen.
So a lot of the data for how companies go come from Rob Wilbank down at Willamette University, and it's a study of exits, how many of the companies that were invested in died a horrible death, how many of them produce a little bit of money, and how much produce a lot. And I've been sort of scratching my head for the last couple of years because I really like Rob's reports, but I can't find the zombies in his data. And I know that there's lots of companies that are out there that are wandering the woods, not making any money, not dying, but going and going and going, and they're not in the data set. And so I don't know what percentage of the companies that are funded have not yet died and are still out there. And I think that's an important contingency to have a plan for.
Well, you should tell Rob he should research that then. So I've got two more questions, and then we'll get into Q&A. So I know some of you are eager to ask the panel some questions. So next month, the Securities and Exchange Commission is going to put into effect Regulation CF, which is about regulation crowdfunding, where entrepreneurs can now could go through an official portal, a regulation crowdfunding portal, and can raise up to $1 million from anybody. You don't have to be an accredited investor to invest in this. Anybody here familiar with regulation and equity crowdfunding, it's also called? So my question for the panel is, what's your opinion about how regulation crowdfunding might impact the deal flow that's coming to your groups and your and you as individual investors?
I think I'll lead off with more of a joke than a well-informed opinion. I think that's a terrible name. Regulation CF. Should have called it Regulation Snafu or something. Just, anyway. Okay. Something that if you're all not familiar with this, look up the HALO report. It's a great little report from the Angel Resource Institute. Easily findable. And I think, is it quarterly or every half year?
It's quarterly.
Quarterly. They do
and Silicon Valley Bank also.
Yep, little study of some key metrics. You can see things like median round size, valuation. And so I'll be interested to watch that. I would expect that as more people start to get into crowdfunding, valuations are going to creep up because there's just more competition for the good deals. But we'll see.
Okay. Anybody else have opinions on this?
Yeah, I do. I think that, how can I say this intelligently? I probably can't. I think crowdfunding on this new CF legislation is going to be an absolute disaster.
Hear, hear.
Because, I guess most of us agree with that. Yep. Because the reason it's going to be a disaster, and I hope I'm wrong, but when you got Mary Smith putting up $1,000 on some deal and she loses her money and she calls her congressman, and I'm simplifying it, yes, but not impossible. So then Congress decides to go the other way. Right now we have $1 million net worth or $200,000 of income and expect to make $300,000 next year, the two accredited investor qualifications for Reg D. I'm concerned that 3 or 5 years from now, Congress comes back and ups those accreditation dramatically because of all the people that lost money in crowdfunding.
No, I agree 100%.
So I think that there's many crowdfunding pathways. I think that CF as the federal level is structured in a way that is too expensive and therefore is actually not going to get used. So the people that use it have not understood it, and they will be spending a lot of energy to get not nearly as much money as they think they were going to get. The state crowdfunding is more interesting, but again, the DFI in the state of Washington has put rules in that are heavy-handed and make it too expensive to do the House Bill 2021 to 2023 program. But there is a program that is interesting, which is called the SCORE program, S-C-O-R, the Small Company Offering something, offer registration. And it's a merit-based evaluation, but it's something that you can then make an offering to people in the state for small amounts of money raising. So I think that we will see more of those happening because that's actually more cost effective. Mm-hmm. 92% of all of the deals we see right now are coming through Reg D. I don't expect that to significantly change. I do think people will be looking at Reg A plus more. And so those that are starting to get some real energy will probably be looking at that and doing something with that. I think that's more likely than the crowdfunding. And strangely enough, in the last 4 months, we've had the Canadian Stock Exchange down here telling us that we should take our companies public in Canada. And having listened to them twice now, I'm starting to do the math to see if they're actually right. And so there might be other pathways that don't involve going through the US SEC to get funding from unaccredited investors.
So on that point about the Reg D, you guys might need to help me out with some of the details. But so there's Reg A, which allows you, so I guess quick background. Reg D means you can only raise money from accredited investors. And Reg D allows those investors to just fill out a simple form saying, yes, I'm a credit investor, good.
The
506B. 506B, right, okay. And then there's a new one that allows...
506C.
C, that allows the entrepreneurs to essentially check the status of a potential investor. It sounded great. A lot of people were excited about it. I just recently had a company try and raise some money under the A provision, and it kind of fell flat with other investors, because it creates a big burden for the company if they don't do the checks right. If the company checks on an investor and doesn't do the check right, and that investor comes in and starts squawking, then it's a big problem for the company, which the prospect of that spooks off other investors. So this new provision sounded really great, and it turned out that people didn't use it.
Bottom line is get a good securities attorney to help you navigate these waters. So, comment, John?
Yeah, for Reg D 506C, the key piece is that it's general solicitation. So it's essentially crowdfunding for angels. You can go on the television and do a television show and say, pay me money right now, and you're legally allowed to broadcast it to the world. With Reg D 506B, it's private solicitation, and you're not allowed to tell anybody. You have to do it privately.
So any other comments about the impact of Reg CF?
Yeah, I think in the shortest term, what we may see is some really funky impacts on valuation and some very awkward conversations shortly thereafter, where someone may have raised $25,000 on a $10 million pre-money valuation and then coming to the serious investors who say, are you kidding? This is $2 million if you're lucky. And then he's got to turn around and talk to his crowdfunders and say, oh, you guys just got an 80% haircut.
Actually, I don't think anybody's going to go into that deal.
I mean, that anyway.
Just won't go in.
They will fall. That's
once somebody has done the crowdfunding, they're done.
Yeah. I took a company public in 96 as a CFO and pitching to big companies on Wall Street. They're investing big bucks. I got a call one day from a guy in Montana. He owned 38 shares. And I was polite. We had a good conversation. What the hell is this person doing investing in the company? And so anyway, I've seen some really ugly cap tables. The longer the cap table, the number of shareholders, the uglier the company. And the longer your cap table, the harder it will ever be to raise a round with a venture capitalist. Last comment is some of the articles I've read in the Wall Street Journal about the crowdfunding is I see people that are basically money handlers and aggregators who are taking 5 or 10%, getting a few press articles, and channeling other people's money. And I would say that's a lousy way to make money. Stick with traditional investment people like Marty Calvert. Don't talk to guys that are in the Wall Street Journal that want 5% off the top in crowdfunding.
Okay, one final question before a Q&A. This is just to stir things up a little bit. And I would like you to answer this question from the point of view of your group, if your group has an opinion about this. But the Washington State Liquor and Cannabis Board just announced earlier this year that the cannabis market is now a $1 billion business in the Washington State. And it's on the ballot, legalization for recreational use is gonna be on the ballot in New York. in Massachusetts, California, Nevada, and several other states come November. And it's been legal here in Washington for several years. So what is your stance on entertaining investment opportunities from companies who are licensed by the state in this regulated business?
Unfortunately, Kritsu Corporate's stand is that we will not invest until it's federally and state legal in all states.
So for Wings, it's pretty simple. It's just completely not in our
space, right?
Medical technology, medical device. We don't do bugs or drugs or anything. So I'm also Alliance of Angels member. Now, as personally, I'm open to it. If it's a great way to make money, I'm open to it. I don't think that's the position of Alliance of Angels. I'll let, let somebody else speak for that.
So I guess at TAGS, we are all about technology. So if there's a technology play to it, maybe we may entertain it. But there is no stance as at the group level yet of what we would do. So we are still open. There are a few members who are actually very actively seeking cannabis kind of deals. So that's where we are.
For the Seattle Angel Fund and the Seattle Angel Conference, it's a function of the members in the fund at that time. And we don't have any particular strategy about particular themes, because we're trying to help people discover what they want, so they have to do the due diligence. Personally, I have absolutely no interest, zero negative interest in being in the space myself, but that's not what the group is doing. The group is evaluating what comes before them. Interestingly enough, we've not seen anybody come before us.
Any other thoughts from anybody else?
Kind of
it doesn't apply to your group, yeah.
We've never had anybody come through. I've had people approach me, and what I've seen is that there's just a lot of unsophisticated people in the game, if you will. The only thing that's of possible interest, and again, we have not had one presenter, but maybe you know somebody that's pretty sharp and is developing something like software would be great for the industry. Because what do we have, three states or four states?
Five.
We got five, and so we know there's going to be more states. And if you got the best product in some space in that industry, you're probably going to do really well.
Okay. Any other comments from the grant? Let's have a round of applause for the panel here for all. All right, thanks again. So the Q&A portion here, Kirby has got a microphone, and because we're recording this, we'd like to have, if you have a question, like to ask it in the microphone so we can get it on the recording. So raise your hand if you have a question. Kirby will help you out.
Thank you for coming tonight, everybody. So what is your best advice, just chime in, on an inventor who has his IP, or she has her IP, and has left the company that she used to work for, or he used to work for, and now he's on his own, so he's starting out, and he has limited amount of money to make it on his own before he has to go back working for another corporation and put all that brain trust back in the private sector away from the angels. What do you suggest if there's like maybe he or she has 3 months of a bankroll before, they have to get back to the Fortune 500 company that they, or go back to the, back to the lab. What would you suggest that person does to make the best use of their time and limited resources?
Yeah. Run really fast, get a customer, get a team, and get the sale by Friday.
I think if the entrepreneur in question really believes in the future of their company and really believes that this is the next big thing, do what you got to do. Mortgage the house, borrow from friends and family, sleep on couches. If you really believe in this and it's going to be the big thing, do whatever it takes. If you're not willing to do all those things, it kind of sends a signal to investors that you don't really believe.
What about intellectual ventures? We lovingly call them intellectual vultures, but they will buy your technology if it's valuable.
I have a question.
But
so
that still doesn't happen in 3 months, though.
He can start it before he runs out of money.
I have a question as well, too. So all due diligence is the basis of how you make your investments and why you make your investments. It seems to me that
do you think there's a startup in actually creating a due diligence? Because CEOs and companies that are starting have to take so much time away from what they're doing to create, to work with the companies to do diligence. Do you think that there is a space for a due diligence company that comes in and actually facilitates that for companies and investors?
He's my husband. He should know the answer to this. So there are professionals that's all they do, is they will get hired, like life science or whatever they're in, and they charge these companies $15,000, $20,000 to do the due diligence. I'm surprised you don't know that.
You didn't tell me.
And more importantly, part of what the goal of due diligence is to know what the entrepreneur thinks about their company. And so watching them go through their due diligence preparation actually is what we care about. It's not the plan, it's the planning that we want to see, which teaches us whether that team's functional or not.
So that's exactly what we look for too when we get a due diligence report as to who's done it and what is his incentive. I'd rather see due diligence done by investors who are really going to write checks and entrepreneurs who should know what they are doing, why they are doing, how they are doing, what are the problems, how they'll solve them, rather than a third party doing it.
Sometimes we'll even ask questions we already know the answers to just to make sure you're telling us the truth.
Okay.
Thank you so much for your time and for being here tonight. As investors, obviously, money is such an important aspect, but what is your stance on other things that you can offer, such as the feedback and business knowledge and connections and introductions? Can you share a little bit about your stance there?
If angel investing at the early stages, in my mind, is a bride price, where you are trying to raise enough money from this person that they will continue to pay attention, and the thing that's most important is their relationships, their experience, and so forth. So that's really what you're buying. But the deal that you make is to take some of their money so that they keep paying attention. And if you make a deal where you just get money, you've made a bad deal.
Yeah, I echo that. You want to choose your investors wisely, because the biggest pain in the ass might give you money, but you don't want to deal with that person for the next few years while you're working on this. So interview them as well as, you know, you interview us as well as we're interviewing you, because you want to be able to get along and have people that you want to work with and that have a vested interest in seeing you succeed, not just someone with a paycheck that's going to hand you some money.
So at TAGS, one of the criteria for our investments is to see if we can add value to the investment, if we can bring something to the table. And at TAGS, Thai Angels Group Seattle, we have at least 25 years of average experience amongst our members, so they have a lot to offer. And beyond just one group, we actually take them to other groups as well globally. So that's, this is interesting for us. We write the check, and instead of getting work done, we actually roll up our sleeves and start working for them.
Yeah, and a point on that, I would say, once you get the check, don't be afraid to let your investors know what you need. I see too many first-time entrepreneurs, every time they see one of their investors, they say, everything's great, everything's great. No, it's a great opportunity to ask for what you need. It's okay if the things aren't going perfectly.
I also want to follow up on...
Especially when they're not going perfectly. Ask for help.
I'd also like to follow up on Sherry's comment about entrepreneurs doing due diligence on investors. It's extremely important because I'm working with a client right now who's got a troublesome investor who's causing problems, and he didn't really do his due diligence on this person before he took the money because he really needed the money at the time, and now he's paying for it in spades. And it just takes a little bit of, somebody up here said, Seattle's a really small town. You can find somebody who knows somebody who knows somebody. And ask around and make sure that you check on the reputation of the investor. By the way, this is Troublesome Investor. Is not a member of any of these groups up here. So just so you know.
Thank you.
Talking about me.
So it's very difficult for someone to say, hey, is Haresh a good investor or not? What am I going to say? But you could ask me whether I would invest with him.
The answer would be what?
I would and have.
I'll give you one comment. I'm on the board of one company, and the only company I've joined a board of in 15 years as an angel, because it's really risky to be a board member in Washington State. because a company cannot, an employee in the company cannot choose to forego a payroll with good intentions without the board members all being personally liable for that. So this is a really crappy state in which to be a board member. Nonetheless, look for people who could potentially be on the board, at least one, and even aside from that board member person, look for people who have a passion that equals or is similar to yours for the company. There's passive investors and casual investors. Look for those with passion, okay, who really get the story and can contribute in some area, technology, sales, marketing, CEO, VC contacts, whatever, and other investor contacts. The company I'm on the board of, I'm representing 22 angel investors from Alliance of Angels. We've had a couple of rounds. But aside from my own personal experience here on that one, if you had 20 investors in an angel round, the first angel round, you better have at least one board member and three who are really evangelists and get the story. Because after that A round of 20, you'll probably have 6 to 12 invest in the B round and maybe 3 in the C round if you're that far along. And so you can only tap out so far with the angel groups and the individuals in the group, and thus those that will carry it the farthest are often those that are most passionate and have the highest probability of helping you get to a VC and get the next round of funding, which is bigger bucks that help carry for the scaling of the company. I hope that's helpful. Yeah.
If you're a Delaware corp, you still got that liability problem with the directors?
Yeah. I can tell you some of Ben Dyker's answer, yes.
All right, next question here.
Hi, I'd like to also thank all of you for your time this evening. My question is about valuation. I've seen a fair amount of variation, for valuation in the first price round. And if you're doing a convertible note with a cap, I'm just curious, how do you all think about the cap in view of, you know, prospective valuation, and what factors do you think is the most important?
Well, I'm going to answer that. We've been around 30 years, and I was raising money for companies 10 years before that, so I've been around for 40 years in this. I've only seen one company that I thought was, the valuation was too low. So that's my sarcastic answer.
So if you do the iteration on the cap all the way to the end, then there's a group of people that believe that caps are valuations. But that's not really true. They're sort of backstops. And so if things are getting really weird and the valuation's shooting up like crazy for the next round, we just like to protect ourselves. And so it's sort of a squint, fuzzy valuation. So it approximates but isn't refined. We know that the Halo report tells us there was a 53% uptick in average valuation in the Northwest in the last quarter. That's crazy. That's a couple of deals that have skewed things more than anything else in my mind. But it's still, we're not going to be seeing lots of people being excited about $4.5 million valuations for very early stage companies. And I would expect those to drop back down to the 2.5 level before such. If you were in Boise, that same deal would be 1.8. So valuation is a function of market and demand.
Yeah, it's more of an art and a sentiment rather than a science, at least in my mind. It's always difficult to come with the right valuation. But again, in the long run, it does not matter. You come in at 3 or 4 or 5. It's, again, building a billion-dollar company. And just to quote Paul Graham, anything below 3 is kind of an angel round. Anything above is kind of not an angel VC round, although lines are blurred now. VCs come in early, angels invest later. But that's kind of a mark somehow angels go by.
So again, to kind of hark back to a comment that was made, is we're all angel groups for which the individual members identify and and pull together as to do the due diligence and negotiate the deal. And really, it's kind of the deal lead in that group who usually is the guy that has the most passion about the deal and gets most involved in fine-tuning terms. And he may, he said, you know, I think if we could get this at 4, would you be in? Yeah, I'd be in for 100. Well, okay, I'd be in for 150 if we could get it at 4. Well, that's too rich, you know. And so there's horse trading going on in the back room. But you ask about the caps and all, and it says that is going to be by guy to gal to guy to gal who's the deal lead there. There's not, I can't say that there is the combined wisdom of the Element 8 angels is.
That's what I was going to say, is that it's up to your investors and what you're willing to give. You got to realize we're not trying to kill you. We want the company to succeed. We will force you to bleed a little bit, but we're not trying to kill the company. You know, we want to make some money. We want to make money. We want you to be successful. The last thing we want is for you to go out of business. But you have to be priced appropriately so that we're not crammed down in the next round. And that's one of the biggest things. That's why it's so important to kind of listen to the investors and listen to the market. And just, if you're stuck at a certain number, you just won't get invested in. You know, if you will not yield, and the investors in the room are telling you something different, you should listen. At least consider it.
Let's just say the valuation is dependent on how convincing your story is to investors.
And
I've had folks I've talked to who really are so hung up on the valuation and becoming zillionaires. I tell them, if you're hung up on being worth $100 million instead of $20 million, you'll probably end up being worth zero because nobody will invest you because you're focused on the wrong thing and you focus only on yourself. So if you've got a passion for the business and creating value, not a lot else will matter because the things will take care of themselves, number one. Number two, Emma Dooley, who's an AOA member, she's a UW number cruncher and entrepreneurial teacher. She did a table once, which I keep. She went through 5 different rounds with the general markup round after round. And basically, the message is don't worry about the valuation. Create value, create top line, create happy customers and employees, and everything will work out just fine. Ending up owning 12% of a huge company is a lot better than owning 40% of a company that stalls out. And my last comment is, I joke with folks, hey, I'll invest in your down round if you invest in mine, okay? Okay. So your biggest risk is getting your valuation too high, rah-rah, excitement and the like, and pricing yourself out of contention for VC money, okay? So the only way in that case when you get back to being able to get VC money is the A and the B round. Folks like us who are in it already have to do a down round when you finally get a VC who will come in because they like your story. Okay, so if you're too high, we lose, we'll smile politely, but you probably lost at the same time for losing momentum and having employees that are unhappy as well.
On the Angel Capital Association website, there's two methods that are strictly art. One is published by Bill Payne, and one is published by Dave Berkus. And you know, if you're interested in valuation, you might go check those two out.
All right, next question. Yes, go ahead.
Great, thank you also, everybody. This has been fascinating. I had a question about resources. There have been a number that have been mentioned tonight. I used Brian's minimum viable company for mm-hmm. two companies that I've worked with right now, and that's been really, really helpful. The book that was mentioned sounds fascinating as well. The internet is a big place. There's a lot of information. Do you guys have other resources like those that you want to recommend to this group that, you know, for people to learn more or to help evaluate their position? Thank you.
I shouldn't do this, but I'm going to. On Friday, anybody who's interested, attack Juan afterwards. We'll give you free due diligence training from the investor side and the presenter side. So it's a couple-hour training that we go through. We've trained over 3,000 people so far. And anybody's welcome to attend, member or not, investor or not. So that's Friday. Talk to Juan.
Two quick comments. Go to the Angel Capital Association website and do a brain suck on that website. Great stuff, number one. Number two, go to the Kauffman Foundation. I think they're affiliated, but basically the Kauffman Foundation is the key brain trust for entrepreneurial and such subjects, really going back quite a few years. One last comment, there's a guy named Phelps who did a study for them about 5 years ago, and I'm speaking to junior staffers here. It says, it's been statistically proven, according to studies, that if you're an untrained techie starting out, you can actually grow faster and learn faster to become an entrepreneur by working with folks who have already had that experience. So again, work for leaders, work for winners, grow fast, don't try and do it on your own. 40 years ago, if you were coming out of school and you wanted to go into finance, you went to Ford. Ford had the roadmap for finance people in the industry. If you wanted to go into sales, you went to Xerox Corporation, okay? There's no one track these days, but the point is, work for winners and leaders, learn from others, you can grow quickly, and you may in fact become a CEO or just a techie who's really happy doing tech stuff.
For the life science people in the room, Life Science Washington is a trade organization for life sciences. They've got some great programs for mentorship. I think UW has some stuff as well. Those are in life sciences. I imagine there's a lot of tech people in here. I wouldn't be surprised to find that there was some tech mentorship programs around. I think if you listen up and you can get in front of those mentors, that's hugely valuable.
You might subscribe to CB Insights. So it's Charlie Bravo Insights.
One thing I found very useful is Paul Graham's website. It's not technical. It's just he started off with his notes, which culminated into a collection, which he put on the website. So there's a lot of practical advice for entrepreneurs and investors, which is, I think, more useful than much of the technical stuff early on for companies, because things will change. You know, it's a chaotic world out there.
We heard early on that market fit was important, so that's the language of Lean Startup, and so I'd really encourage you to read Running Lean and to understand the Lean Customer Development books. Those two books are very tactical, and so one of the things that we see is everybody saying that I'm a lean company when in fact they have no tactical lean behavior. And so understand how to do customer validation, customer engagement before you build your product, get commitments from them early. And if you understand that, a lot of this stuff falls into place.
Coming back in with one more comment. I haven't heard the word mentor come up in the whole session tonight, which I think I want to get this in the mix, whether it's a huge company, tiny or whatever. But find someone who can and is willing to help you both technically, relationship-wise, whatever, but find a mentor, more than one, but those people can help you immensely, and they're better than a magazine, a publication, or a website. Yes. Okay? Find a mentor.
So, Scott, there's a place that you go regularly. The Open Coffee, East Side and West Side, are the beginning of that journey for mentorship in town.
All right, we got the microphone over here. You'll be next.
Yeah, my question is back to convertible notes. And before I ask the question, I have to tell the situation real quick. I run a startup with 16 full-timers in Bellevue, over $1 million in revenues, and we're stuck in evaluation. But we're trying to raise convertible note money so we can test out our secret sauce to grow. We feel that we got the formula. We're looking for a convertible note with no cap at a discounted rate. So something that we can give 70% discount
price
with no
round.
Cap.
Price round.
Don't even try. No. Yeah.
Not interesting for us at all.
Nope. Sorry.
I tried.
I might do a deal like that if I really like the company. And we had an agreement that said if you didn't offer me a 10x return in 5 years, then you turn back half your stock.
That reminds me of a comment I heard a local venture capitalist say. It says, "I'll accept the price for that you're asking if you let me set all the rest of the terms." With raised eyebrows, and I thought, ooh.
Okay, next question here.
Yeah, hi, my name's Scott. And first of all, let me just give a shout out to John and the coffee meetups that he's hosting on the, in Seattle and on the east side as well. A very good investment of your time, especially the network. It's already benefited me greatly. John, you want to tell them what it's called?
Seattle Startups Open Coffee. It's a meetup group, and there's an east side startup open coffee. Both of them meetup groups.
And on the topic of mentoring, I do leadership consulting as my regular job that I'm trying to get out of and get into entrepreneurship. And I'm curious, what are your opinions in terms of investing in help for the people that you're investing in? Do you go try and find people like me to help them get through the process of being good leaders and you know, because what I find in the literature commonly cited is 25% or one third of the failures are due to management inability to disconnect to people to work together. So what do you think?
Well, we have committees that are specific for each industry, and they will help companies from the very inception of your company, the idea stage, all the way through to the funding at Kritzu level stage. But we the whole idea of what we do for all of us, I think, is that we're here to mentor and to help you guys grow and to be successful. I don't think there's anyone up here who has to do what we're doing. We do this because we want to help the community. We want to help the ecosystem here in Washington State.
But if I heard that question correctly, do you guys ever bring in professional assistants in specific topic areas to do coaching and mentoring?
That's exactly my question.
No.
We do. We bring in members.
Well, but as we don't hire outside. We have within, if the competency and expertise exists within our group, we're happy to help collaborate. But writing checks out of our own little meager nonprofit budget, right? No.
And we ask each person in our group, so we have 465 plus members locally. And what I ask is, some years you might be going through a divorce or something's happened, you don't have capital. That's okay, as long as you're still accredited. But I ask that they at least offer 10 to 20 hours of due diligence on a company or two. So Gary, Gary had no money this year for some reason. He can offer his expertise at no charge to the entrepreneur for us in return for still maintaining his membership. So either time or money.
I'll give you one quick comment. The role you're describing is high value, okay? I don't know you, but it's high value. The difficulty is making a living on that in startups. For mid-sized companies, small and medium-sized businesses, and even staying away from the huge companies where you're competing with consulting firms and blah, blah, blah. But it's very tough in the sector that you're here with tonight. But it's a vital role, and small to medium-sized business is there. Second comment is the why. I did a write-up one time about 25 companies I'd invested in, at least 8 or 9 of them that had huge problems. They all came back to the CEO, the CEO's function, capabilities, fit, and how they treated their people. And so you can't help much in that realm with companies that are this small and are technology focused and their hair is on fire because things are changing so fast. Work in small to medium-sized business and you will thrive and you deliver value.
Just a quick general comment in that vein. We've talked about what smart money, what angels bring. As Sherry was talking about, bringing expertise from within the membership, but also don't forget about the angels network. Going back to my point about asking for help, ask for referrals. That's a huge part of what we do. The Wilt Bank study, which I hope you all browse through, one of the key points for what adds value for angels and what increases their ROI is being involved. That's part of what we do for companies and how we increase our own ROI.
Yeah, I might mention the World Bank study showed that if you do 20 hours of due diligence, you got to do at least 20 hours of due diligence, and you do better if you're an investor.
I think as far as, everybody needs a mentor, no matter what. Everybody can do with certain help. What we bring to the table, as I said earlier, is we have members with 25 years of experience, and it's quite varied from startup, serial entrepreneurs to executives and everything in between. So we hope that by the time we write the check, we've identified the strengths and weaknesses of the key core team that we are investing in. And we hope that, okay, we can potentially extend that support that they would need. What the entrepreneur does beyond that might be his own thing, and he may be open to any professional help he may want to. But at an organization level, we do not really promote that.
Okay, I think one question over here.
Sure. My name is Grant Canary, CEO of a company called Drone Seed. We're in Techstars, and we're in cohort right now. We're actually in the Element 8 due diligence process as well. So, question for you is, we've seen in our conversations with VCs, so to share a little bit of the benefit here, a lot of pushback on stacked convertible notes. And I wanted to see if you guys have had issues in your deals with people having stacked convertible notes.
We're always the first note, so we're the cause of the problem.
I asked this specifically because there was some tearing into the safe, and the VCs are like, well, we see a lot of pain down the road because, similar to a very complicated cap table, a lot of stacked convertible notes, and the VCs will actually decline the deal because there's too many stacked notes and there's too many triggers and things and going on. So I'm curious if you have seen that. That's what I'm hearing. And that's not what I've experienced, but I'm hearing
that. If the notes are structured right, then the VC can pull the trigger and fold them all up, and it all goes away.
Okay. Big if, I suspect.
So we actually were in a situation where we had a couple of notes in three rounds. It caused a messy situation. And when we really went for series, whatever, the later rounds, VCs did have a problem. So we actually had to go and just clean up everything and make the conversions cleaned up to an extent that they were then willing to look at it. Now, again, this is an issue when things are not going too right with the company. If things are going right, then it's not that much of an issue.
Go ahead.
Quick point on convertible notes, going back to our discussion about do we like them or not, something just popped in my head. With later rounds, if not just VCs, but if you have a convertible note and there's another round, that next round can force the convertible note holders to rewrite those terms. I've had it done to me. That's another reason not to like convertible notes. It's just a risk that we need, that is good for you to be aware of, that angels are sensitive to. That just because it's that there's signed paper doesn't mean it's going to last.
Let me share one comment. That if a company is running out of money and is not going to make it without more money because they haven't reached the turning point or whatever, or they're going to miss a market because they can't scale and they'll be eclipsed, which is a different way to die. Okay. It doesn't matter what the hell is on the cap table, whether it's notes, A round, B round, C round, whatever it is. If it's going to die, those people will all die together if they don't bend to the terms of a VC who will carry the deal to fruition. Okay? So I wouldn't worry about the structure of it. I would worry about the personalities of the people that you're dealing with on your cap table. Get their attention somehow and have a lawyer help you, have them get a reality check, because when a VC comes in, it's a down round for most everybody, okay? It's a matter of which price, which term, or whatever. It's a down round, but you do it to fund the deal and to get to success for all players, okay? So keep rolling, you'll get there.
See, the idea is to keep it simple, because whatever you do is going to have long-term implications, especially when you survive. If you die, it doesn't matter.
All right, we have time for one more question here. Ian?
Yes, thank you. It's been really enlightening to listen to you guys tonight, and I appreciate the time you've taken. Quick question for you, and it's probably just a short answer from all of you, but do you have a sweet spot for the length of the deal or the horizon for the deal before you decide that it's a bridge too far? A, B, C, D, is it ever going to get launched? Or does it go to IPO?
How many rounds can it go before you're tired of the rounds?
Well, not so much that, but more in terms of your internal evaluation of a deal that says, this is not going to pay out for us in 6 years or 7 years, and therefore we're not dealing with it.
Yeah, we're expecting 10x in 5 years at least.
In the Rob Wilbank data again, there's these earner versus burner notion, and I'm an earner preference kind of guy, and their average in their data is 12 years for earners. And so we preach, you know, 10 to 12 years before you see anything, and if you're not okay with that, then this is not a game you should be in. Hopeful that it's 5x in 10 years or 10x in 5 years. Those two get mixed up often.
I think any startup would need money, right? I mean, one of the ways is raising your own money. You can go through. The second option is funding, angels, VCs, and third is revenue. The first two are always a challenge because that's a liability for the company in a sense. You are either diluting yourself in bringing that money. The best way, obviously, is revenue. And once you start building that revenue, it doesn't matter. You know, various people, investors, will get interested automatically. Whatever you call it, they'll invest. And you'll get to a stage where things will just work out.
I actually have a different thing that we look at it in being in the kind of the clean tech sustainability place. For most of our cases, most of our companies, their markets are in front of them. And the question is, how far out in front of them? And so one of the things, just personally, I'm looking at on the projections is how long to cash flow break even? And do I believe they can get there? And if they can get there and they can survive through the vagaries of slow big company purchase decisions, ultimately when the POs start getting signed, now we get the inflection point on the hockey stick. But I got to believe that they can last long enough to start getting to the inflection point. And the returns over the years, yeah, you know, we kind of have those things that we say, but I have to say that it's not, for me, a strong factor in the get in the deal or not.
Go ahead. I have a comment that they said it all on that point, so I want to make a different comment. For people under 30 here, how many people under 30 here? Okay. I'm 70 years old, okay?
Yeah, you're an older
now,
guy.
I'm an old guy. But these folks have more tread on the tire left, and they can contribute a lot. So if you're under 30, I heard once that I really resonated with is Americans are smart, but the Chinese are wise. Okay. He's laughing. It's true. So there's a value in wisdom, and some of it comes more with age than with brain power, IQ, and tech degrees. So if you're young, you might be smart, but you might not be wise. And these folks and angels and a lot of different folks can help you. Avail yourself of that assistance, and you may become wiser and save your ass.
I got...
All right, Gary, you get the last word.
Okay, I got a little quiz. About 15 years ago, I'm at an event, and one of the leading VC firms was the keynote speaker. And he said they went back through the last 300 successful companies they invested in, and the question was, how many of them met the original pro forma on the first go-around? Any guesses? 6 out of 300, and they were all successful companies.
All 300 were successful.
All right, it's. I promised we'd be done by 8:02. So let's have a big round of applause for everybody. All right. Thanks for your time and attention, and hopefully we'll see you at a future MIT Enterprise Forum event. Thank you.